to order. And the first thing on the agenda is flag flip.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please join me in prayer. Loving Father, thank you for all who are part of our school. Please grant them your encouragement, wisdom, and peace. Strengthen our teachers with their heavy workloads. May they be patient, expecting excellence, and forgiving of mistakes. May they support their students, playing to their strengths, helping with their struggles, and motivating them to do their best each and every day. Comfort and restore those living under shadows of unhappiness, abuse, pain, or fear. Blanket them in comfort, love, and support. Please pour out your blessings upon this board and our whole school community. I ask these things in your name. Amen.
Next is roll call. Mr. Beeson?
Here.
Mr. Ryan?
Here.
Mrs. Rowland?
Present.
Mrs. Tripp?
Present.
Mrs. Liberty?
Here.
And next is presentation and recognitions. Presentation of the Employee of the Month and the Friend of Education Award. Okay, first one is Certified Employee of the Month, and that's Heather Smith.
I'm Stacey Sackery, principal at West Middle School, and I'm proud to announce Heather Smith as the Certified Employee of the Month for March. And here's what we recognized her on our assembly on Friday. This is what we said. Mrs. Heather Smith is being recognized as the Certified Employee of the Month for Ponca City Public Schools. Mrs. Smith is an amazing teacher and represents the PCPS school district so well. She is always quick to help and encourage her students and any WMS teacher or staff member she comes in contact with. Mrs. Smith is one that will put down what she is doing at that moment to help make your day a little better or easier. She will leave notes of encouragement, and she is one of the first to shout with praise when you do something well. West Middle School is lucky to have Mrs. Smith as a part of our staff, and her students are blessed to have her as their teacher.
She's waiting out there. She knows the drill.
Okay, the next award is Support Employee of the Month, and that is Monique Birch.
Monique is a longtime employee of the Ponca City Public School District. She has served in many capacities, but her main expertise lies in federal programs. Monique works in coordination with staff from different departments to manage the grants awarded to the district. Since the pandemic, Monique's work regarding grants and claims has tripled. She goes through each grant with a fine-tooth comb, gathering needed artifacts required that must be uploaded, enters all staff into various grants along with budgets. Anytime these grants are updated or when changes are made, and they're made a lot, Monique is the one that makes the changes and submits the grant for approval. But where she really shines is submitting claims for the various grants. Monique is truly an expert when it comes to coding, regulations, allowability, and documents that are required and needed to ensure claims go through and the district is reimbursed. Monique is a joy to work with and a real team player. She remains positive regarding her duties and is always willing to help out within other departments when needed. It is for this reason and many more that Monique deserves this honor.
Congratulations. The next award is Friend of Education, and that's Linda Lines and the ConocoPhillips Retirees Association.
I'm Mark Lowaki. At Garfield Elementary, and we want to recognize Linda Lyons and the ConocoPhillips 66 Retirees Association. They're the Friends of Education for March. They have so generously donated their time to Garfield's kindergarten classrooms for many years. We are so blessed to have them volunteer in our classroom once a week to tutor kids in letter recognition during the first semester and sight words during the second semester. In addition to the countless hours they have given to our classrooms, they have helped provide transportation The field trips donated money during COVID to provide materials for the children and brought party items for Christmas and the end of school year parties. Also, each year during the holidays, they give generously. They donate money generously to buy our students blankets, mittens, hats, puzzles, books, and numerous other items. They are truly assets to our school, and we are so blessed to have them spend time weekly in our classrooms. Thank you sincerely.
Okay, if everybody that won an award will join us, will go out in the hall, just you'll take your pictures.
We probably don't need the lights for the, in the back.
Here, I got it, Shelley.
I wanted to speak to Ms. Hines anyway.
Okay, the next thing on the agenda is public comments, and I do not think, I don't think we have any tonight. Nobody wants to speak to the board. So that was number three. So number four, reports with potential board discussion. The 2022 dropout report, and Delana Hawkins is going to present that.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yeah, it's on.
Good evening. I am here to present the 2022 Ponca City Dropout Comparison Report. We are required to do this annually for the accreditation, our state accreditation from the district level. As you can see, this report began before my role here, 2014, and our most recent year that has been added is 2022. POHI had 16 that followed the definition or the state's definition of a dropout. Our alternative programs had 3, East Middle School had 1, and West had 3. As you can see, that is down from last year, which is good news. And if you need to know, the state defines a dropout as any student under the age of 19 who has not graduated from high school, is not attending any public or private school, or is otherwise receiving an education pursuant to law for the full term of the school district in which he or she resides or in or are in session. So, do you have any questions?
Have the rules been the same since 2014?
Yes, the definition has been the same.
So why was 2017 such a good year compared to this year, the last couple of years?
Well,
the pandemic,
I can find out. The pandemic did cause the increase, the significant increase. We were hanging around 4 to 7, which had dropped from the previous years. So I can't speak to the increase or the drastic increase. It's better than I can speak to the 25, the smaller numbers.
Isn't there something where they move and they don't report?
That's correct.
Yes, that reporting process has become far more transparent into our student information system. The state now, beginning last year, the state can see immediately. So our, now I do have to sing the praise of our site secretaries and just across the district and at every site. They are doing an amazing job. We actually, the initial report was 71, and I was able to filter through all of the records, our people, and appeal those with the state. I was able to appeal more than 48 because of their efforts to collect amazing records upon withdrawal, and they're attaching those in our student information system. So I can't sing their praises enough.
And that's likely what happened at East and West.
And these are students, I can tell you, I can speak to the numbers on the board. They may, many of them, move out of state, and then we work to track down those records, but we have very, I think the mobility has increased with transient jobs. We have a lot of families that might go to North Dakota to work in the oil industry, but then there's a period of time before their students are enrolled or they enroll in a private school that doesn't report records the way public schools do. And so these are ones we weren't able to chase down, if you will.
Thank you.
So with 20 through 23, the more kids go into EPIC? I mean, or do you think these dropouts are going to EPIC, or is it?
We have,
they have to go to EPIC records.
They're not in the report.
These are more maybe.
True dropout.
Yeah, or moving to North Dakota or South Carolina.
Or homeschool.
And I have to be able to prove with documentation to take them off.
Does the state do anything with this information as far as following up those families to find out why they would drop out in the first place? Like, for any days or any other before those, anything in there? Or they just collect?
The very few who are actual dropouts, which there are a few on there, I can speak to life circumstances. There's some heavy COVID trauma in there and a necessity to work full-time to support family. Yeah, I hear that. Out of the few that I can say that are actual, I can't attend school anymore. Tough times, that's another aspect of those spiking numbers. There's some real trauma out there that, families, hardships. Great question.
Can I get any more questions for Alana?
See it again next. Hopefully we'll go down some more.
Thanks, Alana.
Number five, superintendent's report with potential board discussions. We're going to talk about the legislative updates and the proposed transfer policy.
Legislative update. Coming up, it was a super busy week at Capitol. This last week, because there was a deadline looming, and bills had to come out of committee. So the first deadline is passed for bills to remain active, passed on March 2nd. They had to come out of committee to go to the floor. And initially, we were tracking over 450 bills. Now we're down to 148. And because of our advocacy of our educational groups, there were a lot of additional bills that were stopped regarding mandates like red tape rules. That's been one of our focus for our legislators, just take something off our plates as far as reporting. So appropriation bills or bills that have to do with funding will have an extra week to pass the budget committee. So by the end of this week, we're going to have a firm number on how many bills are going to advance to either floor. And then floor work will remain a high priority through the March 23rd deadline for bills to be heard on the Chamber of Origin. So on February 26th, the House approved the House Education Plan through two bills, House Bill 1935 and House Bill 1775, and these were attached as a pair. And part one has to do with Oklahoma Parental Choice Tax Credit. And this was an answer to the voucher bill. It was in response to the Education Savings Account bill. But basically, a tax credit would go to anyone choosing to send their children to a private school at $5,000 per child, and there's no income cap. So no matter what part of town you lived in, or no matter what your income threshold is, if you had four kids attending private school, you would get a tax credit, not charitable deduction, a deduction, a tax credit on your taxes. So it wouldn't be like a deduction. Now, the House is proposing this rather than the voucher bill, because the voucher bill would pull money from state funds and from public schools and give to private schools. But any tax credit does not go into the general fund, so which means that we would reduce taxes overall across the state. Part two is the funding portion. And section one has to do with teacher pay raises, and it's $2,500 across the board teacher pay raises. And there's some interesting clauses within this bill. It's for active classroom teachers who remain in the same school. So technically, if we got new teachers in, we wouldn't have to give that $2,500 to new teachers, but that's gonna be a problem, I will tell you, if that comes to pass. We've gotta treat all of our teachers the same. It would not increase the minimum salary schedule. Everyone would receive the $2,500. And we had a lot of meetings last week with our different organizations, and some of the legislatures are saying pay that as a stipend, because if there is a revenue failure, the money won't be there to pay those, and contractual rules do not let you pay lower than you did the previous year. So that's not going to curb anything with the teacher shortage, and frankly, I'm not sure $2,500 is even going to touch the surface on that. It's not so much about money with teachers, but we need to be above the regional average. But yeah, this stipend thing, I can tell you that our organizations aren't liking that. We need sustainable money to pay our teachers more. And this money would flow through the state aid state aid formula. Section 2 is the Redbud portion, and there already is legislation out there for the Redbud school grant. And if schools receive little or no funding for building funds, that means their ad valorem, their local property taxes, fall below the state average. Ponca City has never qualified for Redbud funds, and I doubt that we ever will, just because of our ad valorem that we have in our district. But this is an additional $50 million for schools to help with building fund issues and fall below the average of property taxes. Section 3, this is a big one. It's ABMs, and $300 million is going to be distributed on a weighted average daily membership based on the number of students you had the previous year, with a $2 million per district limit. And there was a floor substitution on this late last week. I think I gave you all some information in the memo that I sent out and to our teachers as well. Originally, the Senate was going to do this on average daily membership. That's your number of kids you have enrolled, and it made a significant difference. So it needs to be weighted. Different kids have different needs, but there are 42 districts in the state that would be capped at $2 million. And I'm going to show you just a slight comparison of this. At your tables, I have the projections if you want to see what a specific school is, but I'm going to talk to you just a little bit about some of the concerns with this. So here's the fiscal year 22 weighted ADM, the fund projection, and the per weighted ADM. So Oklahoma Public Schools has the highest weighted ADM, and I'm not going to read those numbers to you. You can see them. They would get $2 million because they would be capped. So that's $36.10 a student per pupil. Okay, here we go for Lawton Public Schools, and I didn't go down in order. I just tried to pick and choose. They're capped at $2 million, and you can see where their weighted ADM is less than half, or about half, of where Oklahoma City Public Schools is. And their per pupil, based on that, is $88.05. Ana Public Schools, yet again about half, they're capped at $2 million. Their per pupil is just short of $161. Here's Ponca City Public Schools. We fall within those top 42 schools. There's our weighted ADM, not quite half of what Enid's is. Fund projection, $2 million, $282.18 per student is what we could expect. Western Heights is the smallest school that's capped at $2 million. So they would receive $441.33. Now, the rural schools, the smaller schools, they're across the board, it's $441.50. I just grabbed Fort Gibson Public Schools. I rounded that. It's $1.2 million something. Blackwell Public Schools, they're going to have $441.50 per student. Newkirk Public Schools, even smaller than Blackwell, they're still going to get $441.50 per student. Yale Public Schools in our area, look at their weighted ADM. They're going to get $441.50 per student. McCord, that's in our area, so I wanted to show them. And then the smallest school in the district is Davidson Public School. They have a weighted ADM of 55.2. That's not very many students. I mean, you've got the weights added in there. They would get around $24,000, $441.50. So concerned with the educational groups, we're all pleased about any additional dollars that may run through the formula, but the concern is Enid Public Schools kids are worth just as much as Davidson Public School kids. So we don't want to divide that line between suburban and rural schools, suburban and urban and rural schools, and that's exactly what this does. Now, before they had the house substitution, it was huge. The smaller schools all got like $733 per child. I think we were at 400 and something, and Oklahoma City got about $60.
Shelley, isn't the logic that the legislature is using here is that the valuations of the bigger towns are higher, so therefore the rural schools
that
need more money?
That is the exact logic, but you've got those Red Mud grants too that feed back in for those that have don't have a high net assessed valuation too.
Which is probably the below the 42.
Probably.
Mark. But I mean, that's the theory they're using, right or wrong.
That's the theory they're using, and right or wrong is exactly right, but they are getting additional funds through both Red Bud grants in part two of this funding and the original Red Bud grant. And the state aid formula is the most equitable that it can be. Our ad valorem goes against us for a chargeable. There's five or six chargeables that go against us, and you know, to make it equitable, schools that don't have a great deal of ad valorem or GPT, they're getting more of a piece of the pie.
Well, like
McCord
probably doesn't have hardly any ad valorem.
They have some.
But not
like we did.
Ponca City with Ponca.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. But that's a chargeable for us, so it's equitable based on the number of students.
Next time for us production.
Yes. Correct. So I made a copy of all the schools for you. If you just ever want to take a look at it in my spare time, you can see that. So take a look at this. This is pretty telling. I kind of made this little chart too. So the district size 1 through 42 are going to get $84 million, which is 28.02% of the projected revenue, compared to 43 through 540, $215 million. 72%. The projected revenue is right at $3 million. So that can tell you the difference between the top 42 and the 43 through 540. Okay, so I think I may have told you about this in the memo, but Senator Pugh's Recruit, Retrain, Reward Reform Plan, I'm not gonna go through it, I'm gonna go through the reward portion with you. It is Senate Bill 482, which would raise the base salary for public school teachers at different steps. First through 4 years by 3,000, 5 through 9, 4,000, 10 through 14, 5,000, and then 15 plus could see raises of $6,000. It passed unanimously after Senate Education. The bill moves next to the Senate Appropriations and Budget Committee because this has to do with funding. So we will know the Senate's stance. I think there's going to be some action in response to the House bill this week because there's that next deadline coming up. So here's what the educational organization's position is. We want additional pay for teachers, and we want additional operation costs and program continuation, but we want it to be distributed fairly among the districts and through the state aid formula. Because if it goes through the formula, it is equitable. Those of us that have more GPT or more ad valorem or more county four mil, whatever it is, it's a chargeable then for us. The positive news is that all branches seem to want to help Common Ed across the board, from the governor, the state superintendent, the Senate, and the House. So, and we are very appreciative of that. So we're continuing to engage in conversations with our legislators, and I think this will be a big week for us. Oh, here's a big one. I'm just gonna throw this out to you. I'm not going to read this to you, but these bills passed in committee last week, and it has to do with board elections, and they're both very similar. It would reduce the term of a board member from 5 years to 4 years. And one of these has office one and two would be up for re-election at the same year of 2025. And then you would be on a 4-year cycle. The other bill, 1823, would move board elections to only odd number of years. There's also some increased training for board members who serve 3 and 4 year terms. And so this is kind of the movement to go to the 4 year terms of the board. We'll let you know how this turns out. It's just gone through committee. So some House bills of interest. This was a big interest. Zach and I messaged back and forth on this. On the day that it failed, this would have required a creation of a statewide portal where commenters could review and comment on textbooks, library books, and more. And as Zach said, tests and AP material. And by law, we can't give out AP material. So, number one, somebody would have to create this portal at the State Department, and they need some employees just like everybody else does. And then number two, we would have to upload all of our information onto this portal, and someone would have to do that. Now, we may not see the commenters. Here's the thing. You all have established policies where they can review any of our curriculum, where they can come in, and we can have that face-to-face conversation. If you're just giving commenting, that reduces that face-to-face conversation, and we would rather have those relationships with our patrons. So these bills passed in committee. 1840 moves child nutrition program to the Department of Ag. This was a big push last year, and it's another big push this year. Jeff says it really doesn't matter to him if it moves from the State Department of Education or to the Department of Agriculture. Basically, they may not audit you so much if it moves to, but it won't make any difference in money for us. Our legislators think that it can be a big bonus, more streamlined, and that we could get more dollars. Don't know. House Bill 1882 removes the single summative report card grade and A to F language. And I can tell you that public schools are about that. Let's work on growth. You know, the summative grade and the current A to F language. And there's way more details to that. And if it passes, we'll get to that. And then House Bill 2007 allows for the search of the shoes, socks, hand and head coverings of students. So if we have reasonable suspicion. So right now we have them empty their pockets. We have a female and a male present. If it's a male principal and it's a female student, but we could ask them to remove their hat or their beanie, their socks and shoes. Don't know. We'll see where that goes. Senate bills of interest that passed in committee, busy week. This is Senate Bill 99. It modifies the language relating to school employee payroll deductions. Basically, we can't have a deduction like association dues unless it is reauthorized every year, and it has to be on a form prescribed by the State Superintendent of Public Education. So it did pass out of Senate Bill 360. Requires every public elementary site to employ a reading specialist to assist in providing literacy and reading instruction to students in grades 3 and below. And let me tell you, if we could find teachers, we would love to do that. So there's that. Senate Bill 526, the Senator Pugh as well, it removes TLE, and there are certain components that it would remove, and we'll talk more about that if it passes. Senate Bill 527, modifies the state aid funding formula. It replaces the definition of bilingual with English learner, and that's what we call it, EL. And this measure increases the transportation factor from 1.39 to 2.0 for kids that live within a mile and a half of the district. So that could help schools as well. Oh, and they may, there could be some grade level and category weights. There's some talk about half day pre-K being weighted higher than full day pre-K, and the superintendents are all talking, well, why would we have full day if we get more weights for half day pre-K? But I can promise you that will never fly. We won't do that to our parents. It's hard, you know, they would have to take care of being the other half the day. Any questions on the legislative update?
Back to your very first slide. What about homeschool? You didn't mention homeschool.
Oh, homeschool, it's a $2,500 tax credit. Good question, Mr. Riley. I did not mention homeschool. $5,000 for private schools and $2,500 for homeschool children. And there has not been any mention of accountability for assessments, standards, auditing, that kind of thing. Oh, one other thing that I didn't mention, but it was up there on the funding portion of the $300 million, the $2 million cap for 42 large pools specifically says it can't go for administrative costs. So, just for...
Is debt touching the rainy day fund for all this funding?
Yeah, somebody, they're going to have to.
I mean, they haven't really come up
no.
where they're, how they're paying for all this.
The good news is our rainy day fund is bigger than it's ever been. Okay.
But we're also asking for more for education.
And you know, I will tell you, even our legislator, Senator Coleman, his concern is that is a lot of money, and people do not want to go through revenue failure again. Because you know what happens when we go through revenue failure? You know, where our biggest expense is staffing. So nobody wants to go through that again. And that's for every agency, but for, you know, they're concerned about the cost.
Why do you think they haven't mentioned, if they're going to give money to private schools and homeschools, if they don't make accountability like we are held accountable?
Well, I think that we'll keep pressing that will be mentioned. These haven't even made it out of committee yet. So, you know, what have we done? Just a month of session?
Yes.
We just finished 4 weeks. We're starting with 5. So I think that will be mentioned because that is a huge priority for our educational organizations.
These last few that you were just talking about, what's the next step on those ones?
Well, if it has to do with money, they have an extra week for it to go into appropriations, and then it has to go to the House of Origin. It has to be through the House of Origin by
March 23rd.
Yes. So it's going to get fast and furious. Those are just some. Oh, a lot more passed. You could have been here all night, 148, but I just wanted to share the ones of interest. So, the next thing that I want to talk about is yet again a recommended change to the student transfer policy. And if you remember, that went into effect in January of 2022, and I brought it to you 3 or 4 times to change, and the law says that you have to change it whenever your capacity limit changes. And you remember it's based on attendance, behavior, and capacity limits, and then it can go to the State Board of Education for appeal. Well, what happens at midterm across the state is people lost teachers, people added teachers. I mean, we added 2 teachers, a kindergarten and a 5th grade at Lincoln. Well, that means the board has to come in and approve. So our REOs and superintendents have been talking. And our RAO got approval from the state. Let's have a generic policy that says what we're going to do. And then if there is an appeal, it can be checked by our student information system and the state personnel report. And I'll explain that to you. And technically, we probably won't be changing this year. I mean, it doesn't probably need to be changed this year because it didn't affect our capacity rate a bit because we added it was still a no at both kindergarten and 5th grade levels. But while this is on my mind, I wanted to go ahead and take care of this before next year so someone else won't have to do it. So the first 2 bullets, we are good. So basically what it says is pre-K through 3, our capacity is set at 20 students per classroom. And it goes on to say that we'll multiply those limits times the number of classroom teachers employed by the school district at each level for each school site. Well, that's easy enough. We can do that. And that's fine. We don't have to change it because we can modify at pre-K through 3. For 4th and 5th, we can do the same thing because basically it says the same thing at 22 students per classroom. But look what we had for, and most districts did. For grades 6 through 12, capacity is set based on the number of ELA teachers at each grade level, and that's so that we can plan for in-district growth, provide adequate staffing, and make sure that our class sizes are not too full. But we want to further add in green, the capacity limit is 120 students per ELA full-time equivalency teacher. The district will multiply this limit times the number of ELA teachers employed by the school district. Skip the Ponca City Virtual, the next arrow, but look what I have stricken. So we had it defined. The current capacity of students per grade level in 6 through 8 is 360. Okay, so we had 120 we had three teachers in each grade level, three LA. So at 120, we established it. But, you know, sometimes we could have less. The capacity at the high school was 9 through 12 was set at 340 because I think we just have 9.75 teachers. I don't know what our full-time equivalency is. But if we don't have to set that number, you all will not have to go in and change, and the next superintendent won't have to bring this to you every time. If we just say, base it on 120 per ELA full-time equivalent. Then we had to add, not too long ago, it was required that we add for our virtual academy. We actually established that down below, and I've got it stricken. We had 20 students based on the number of teacher in K through 8 and 9 through 12. So actually, our capacity limit is 20 students per full-time equivalency teacher. You know, at some point, we just may have only six teachers. I mean, we just have, we may have a teacher like 3 days a week at Ponca City Virtual. So you guys won't have to come in and approve this every time. And it's been a problem across the state, and our State Department of Education gave our REOs the authorization to make it generic. And if it comes to an appeal, they can check our student information system and our state personnel reports. So the recommended changes are in green. Any questions about that? Because, I mean, you can lose a teacher at any given time of year, and then it needs to, they need to come back to the board. Okay. That is it. Okay, Christine, might get that light.
Okay, number six is consider and take action on the proposed transfer policy change that's presented in the superintendent's report. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion. I'll second that one.
Any other questions?
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Mrs. Tripp?
Aye.
Mrs. Zimmerstein?
Aye.
Mr. Mitchell?
Aye.
Next thing is a consent agenda. Motion is required for the approval of the consent agenda as printed or as amended. Board members may, however, call for a separate vote on any or all items listed on the consent agenda. Okay, these are contracts under $10,000, out-of-state travel requests, minutes of the last board meeting, foreign exchange agreements.
Motion approved.
Yes, let me tell you what that's about. You originally approved these bylaws on request of the attorney for the committee, and that was back in October, but they made an amendment. They are establishing an endowment that will run through Ponca City Public Schools, and it's and the bylaws are in your packet, and it just talks about the endowment. So they're changing the bylaws, so this is just further approval.
Question, Christy, you got the change made?
Yeah.
Okay. Say that one more time.
We had the wrong title for Brenda.
Anna, I made the motion, do I have a second?
Yes, I made the motion. Yes.
Okay, number three, consideration and take.
Are we going to vote then?
Yes, sorry.
Okay.
Mrs. Zimmershed?
Aye.
Mr. Newman?
Aye.
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Mrs. Tree?
Aye. Okay, number three, consider and take action on the following contracts and agreements. And we need to go through these stuff.
Probably, Adam can talk to you about A and B, and then we'll move on to C.
Okay. A is the consideration and take action on the construction manager's report on the Howe restroom renovation project.
We were anticipating estimating $150,000 for flooring. Each of these came in under our estimated cost, so this GMP is actually lower than what we estimated for the remainder of the Howe High School there. So with approval there, this would be a federal CARES project. We can get started on through there.
Okay, B, consider Anderson flooring flooding.
Is that what should be flooring
to install carpet tile?
Yeah, so this is, again, another ESSER II project, so we pay with federal funds. This was to catch the remaining flooring at the registration building the public utilizes during registration that we weren't able to get last summer.
Okay. Number C, agreement with Apple Incorporated for replacement iPads.
Okay, we have a four-year refresh, and that's what the pre-K center use, our Apple iPads, and it's just over $114,000, and there's no negotiating with Apple. Their product sells themselves. We tried to negotiate on everything. I've gave it to Ryan. He did try. But they
tried.
Okay. D is agreement with Ingenuity.
Yes.
Incorporated for concurrent user licenses for Wildcat Academy.
Okay, let me just address D, E, and F. They're
okay.
All for Ingenuity, and the first one, D, is for our licenses for Wildcat Academy. E is for our concurrent user license for Poe High, which is our credit recovery. And then F is for our online licenses for PCVA kids 6 through 12. This was a three-year contract. This is just ratification of the contract for all three, D, E, and F. So, I'm going to go to G.
Yes. Agreement with Frontline Education for HR software.
Okay, this is our time and attendance, our absence, we call it ASOFT, it's our absence software. This is also our recruiting software, so it's huge for HR. It's how we operate for our application system and all kinds of business transactions. So it is almost $40,000.
Okay, I, agreement with Hinman Enterprises LLC, ABB Hinman Lawn Care for mowing services.
Okay.
For this summer.
It's actually going to start after spring break, well, during spring break, so if this is approved tonight, and the cost is around $35,000. We did skip H, too.
Okay. Agreement with Haddock Education Technologies to replace active panels.
These are at our refresh sites, which are Union, Roosevelt, Garfield, and Washington, and those are refreshed every 4 years for our Promethean boards and active panels.
Okay, J, agreement with Imagine Learning for 40 single user licenses for students at Ponca City Virtual Academy.
Originally, that was Ingenuity as well, and when we had that contract, it wasn't a three-year contract, it was a year at a time, and Ingenuity has now changed to Imagine Learning for its elementary students. So it will be paid out of ESSER funds and out of that 20%. for both math and ELA. It is almost 17,000. It includes IXL Elevate 2. We use it in our professional learning communities to plan for instruction and use it to collect data.
How many high school students do you use this? Oh, 950.
950.
Is that by grade or how?
It's mostly
9 through 11.
Yeah. 9 through 11, so you don't have your students.
And some seniors, but not all seniors. It's preparation for data collection of ACT.
Agreement with Justin Incorporated to write copies of the 2024 yearbook for Ponca City High School.
This is about $27,000, almost $26,000. It's paid out of the activity funds and it's going to be reimbursed through the sale of the yearbooks.
Okay, M. Agreement with Angela Reinhardt, Montenegro, NCSP, MSES, school psychology.
She's certified. She's a school psychologist. And we have one, and then we contract with one, and we are really struggling to stay in compliance with all of our testing requirements. So this lady reached out to us, and in fact, I think Amy had talked to her earlier, and we actually talked to you about it last month at committee, but we needed to check certifications and things like that. And this does, she is going to be driving from Belle Plaine, Kansas, and we are paying her mileage. So this is for the last quarter at just over $25,000. And we'll revisit it again. We hope to get our own school psychologist, but right now we're struggling with the same.
Okay, agreement with Reading Plus for 5 license at Ponca City High School.
Okay, and you, I think all of you know what Reading Plus is, and this is just a third year of the 3-year agreement, so it's just ratification for N, O, and P for Ponca City High School, East Middle School, and West Middle School.
So all both are the same, just at different levels.
Mm-hmm. And it's no cost to the district, it's just ratification.
Q, agreement with Trafera for laptops and desktop computers.
Okay, this is for the refresh for the buildings Roosevelt, Garfield, Union, and Washington for the teachers' laptops and desktops. And that quote is $125,000 and it comes out of bond funds for all of our refreshes too.
Okay. R, agreement with Trafera for the summer refresh for 3 elementary schools and Ponca City High School.
That's right. Okay, so the reason we just have 3 of the elementary schools and not Washington, they use those Chromebooks. iPads. So typically we order 1,600 Chromebooks with cases at the high school, but total. This is for all sites, Roosevelt, Garfield, Union, and Pohai. But we don't need 1,600 because Washington uses the iPads.
Okay, so that's why you only ordered 1,200?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, S?
Wait a minute.
Okay.
Why wouldn't all schools use the same device?
Well, pre-K students, it's hard for them to use a Chromebook with their fine motor skills and their dexterity of their fingers, so they use iPads if they push buttons.
So the pre-K is the only one that
the
uses
pre-K is the only one that uses Apple products.
Ratification of an agreement with Stephen H. McDonald and Associates Incorporated in connection with any issuance of general obligation bonds by the district.
This is our financial advisor, and Mr. Riley asked what that percentage was. Ours is capped at $55,000, so it is scheduled in the fee of $55,000, so it's not a percentage.
And that is actually a bond issue.
Correct. As a fee.
That's the last one. Agreement with the Ultimate Pest Management Performing Services.
Same thing, we'll start, does it start
start next week to get approved tonight.
If you don't approve it, I went out there with a push mower.
Good.
Wait, why don't you leave it in the trash?
There's no question, ma'am.
So the trash is being picked up for the mower.
It's been windy these last few days.
Yeah.
I've seen our people out there picking it up today. I was all over this.
And that was in this year's contract, that there's sticks or trash they are to pick it up, not just mow around it.
Not mow over it or around it.
Make a motion to approve A through
T.
T.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Yeah.
Mr. Newsom?
Aye.
Mr. Riker?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Mrs. Tree?
Aye.
Mrs. Ernest?
Aye.
Next one is consideration to take action on the following change orders. Change order on the Liberty Elementary renovation project.
This was the work that the Millbrook contractor had thought was included in the original scope of the Liberty project. It was not, so by approving this change order, the district will save $36,819.
With my statement, B, take action on a change order for the Bo Ag improvement project.
This one was, we knew this one was coming, we talked about this in committee. Our Bo Ag farm is in state fire marshal jurisdiction, not city of Ponca City jurisdiction, and the state fire marshal has deemed the ag barns as fire risk, so we have to put three fire alarms in all of the barns with monitoring services at that cost. So those are going to be the safeness sheep and chickens in Head County.
Crazy.
Do I have a motion for number four, A and B?
B comes out of general funds, correct?
Correct. Well, yeah, building money.
I have to make a motion.
Second.
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Mrs. Tree?
Aye.
Mrs. Ernest?
Aye.
Mr. Newsom?
Aye.
Okay. Next on the agenda is motion and vote to convene an executive session for the following purposes: to discuss the possible termination, reassignment, resignation, and employment of personnel on the attached detailed personnel report; to discuss the employment of executive directors and directors; to discuss the employment of a superintendent; to negotiate, to discuss negotiations; and to discuss confidential conversations with the board's attorney concerning pending claims and litigation. Do I have a motion to go into executive session?
I will make a motion.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
Mrs. Rowland?
Mrs. Tree?
Aye.
Mrs. Dershowitz?
Aye.
Mr. Newsom?
Aye.
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
We are now in executive session. We're returning to open session. Number seven, recital by the board president that minutes of the executive session were kept by the board minutes clerk and will remain confidential. Number eight, consideration and take action to hire a new superintendent effective July 1st, 2023. Do I have a motion?
Yes, I have a motion to approve. Adam Leaning as the new superintendent at July 1, 2023.
Nancy seconded it. So call for the vote.
Mrs. Tree?
Aye.
Mrs. Zimmershi?
Aye.
Mr. Newsom?
Aye.
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Okay, number nine, consideration to take action on recommendations for termination, reassignment, resignation, and employment of personnel. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to vote.
Second.
Mrs. Zimmershi?
Yeah.
Mrs. Tree?
Aye.
Mrs. Rowland?
Aye.
Mr. Riley?
Aye.
Mr. Newsom?
Aye.
Do we have any new business?
None.
Okay. We are adjourned.